Bob, thank you. Welcome to Rupp Arena and the SEC on ESPN. Here on their home court where the Cats have won 30 of their last 31. They get an undefeated SEC opponent. Texas A&M is 5-0 in the SEC and sitting atop the SEC standings alongside Alabama. Both of them undefeated. Kentucky now into the top half of the league thanks to a late run. The Cats have won 4 of their last 6. Have they figured it out? Well, it was bad for a while, and that includes their first ever home loss to South Carolina. But then these Kentucky players, as they said, rallied for their coach. They went on the road to Rocky Top. They shocked fifth-ranked Tennessee. Oscar Tshiebwe had a great game in that one. He had an even better one, perhaps his best ever, against Georgia. He exploded for a career-high 37 points. He ripped down 24 rebounds and reestablished himself in the Player of the Year running. Welcome, everybody. Tom Hart alongside Jimmy Dykes. Feels like, seems like, looks like, Jimmy, the Kentucky's figured it out.
It does. The juice is back in the Kentucky program. This is the toughest ticket to get in Rupp so far this season. And for Kentucky, what have they done? Well, they've grinded their way on the offensive end, and they're starting to figure out what they need to do defensively. But it all goes through Oscar Tshiebwe, Tom, who was dominant. Absolutely dominant in this building on Tuesday night, 37-24, historical numbers. Now, he was single coverage by Georgia. That will not happen today against Texas A&M, who is a very aggressive, trap the life out of you, disrupt you defensive ball club. Oscar Tshiebwe has to handle the double team. He has to pass out the double team and still be a scorer. But make no doubt about it, Kentucky believes they are back.
Meanwhile, Buzz's team has won 7 in a row. Going back to last year, they've won 9 straight SEC games. The team certainly takes on his personality.
Absolutely they do, man. He is a fighter at his core, and his team embraces it. It's a Texas A&M team, a little bit undersized, but man, do they play hard. And they can win a lot of ball games, Texas A&M, when the game's in the 50s. I think that's where they want to keep it today. But a very aggressive scramble the game mentality that Kentucky's up against today against the Aggies.
These are two great rebounding teams. They are grinding out on the defensive end. Kentucky coming off of that win against Georgia. They put 85 points on the board. They get 23 of those from the free throw line. First play was to get Oscar Tshiebwe in the perimeter, guarded by Julius Marble. Here's Cason Wallace, and the freshman leaves it short off of Oscar and perhaps off of Marble, who was laying out of bounds. Instead, it'll be Texas A&M basketball. We know A&M's personality. They are tough-minded on the defensive end. How would you describe them on the offensive side?
They drive the heck out of the basketball. They are a downhill team. At times, they can struggle to score a little bit from distance. If the three ball is not a big part of their offense. But those guards, Wade Taylor and Boots Radford, they are hard to keep out of the paint.
That was not an out-of-bounds call. That was a personal foul called on Oscar Tshiebwe. Just a half minute into this game,
A&M ran guys at Tshiebwe on the shot attempt.
Loose ball corralled by Henry Coleman, and he'll take it in, but pick up the charge. A&M and Kentucky both great at offensive rebounds. A&M top 10 in the country in offensive rebound percentage.
Kentucky has flipped their defensive mentality in the last two ball games, and Toppin has led the charge. A tremendous on-ball defender is Toppin for a 6'9 guy, can chase shooters, got his feet outside the restricted arc.
The 1-2-2 look from A&M. Wallace tries to back out of it. He'll find Livingston. Here's Livingston, takes it all the way.
Tom, these are the two best rebounding clubs in the SEC, both offensive and defensive efficiency.
Early three from Dexter Dennis, who had been red hot from deep. He'd made 6 out of his last 7, and already a second offensive board for the Aggies. Tyrese Boots Radford will help run the point. He's emblematic of this A&M team. He is tough, he is hard-nosed. Tried to dish it on the drive in an A&M turnover. Both teams a little sloppy early.
Yeah, like everybody else right now, trying to draw Oscar Tshiebwe into a ball screen defender. Tshiebwe did a pretty good job of retreating, staying in front of the ball, making the pass go through traffic.
What does Kentucky want to do against this A&M defensive?
Well, you got to attack. Because if you're A&M, if they don't attack and make you pay for extending the defense, the Aggies eventually, they'll start trapping the life out of you around that half-court line.
Well, Cason Wallace getting another start at point guard. Xavier Wheeler had been there, but then missed the Tennessee game with an injury after colliding with Oscar Tshiebwe in practice. Shot clock late. It is at 3. Wallace, pull up. That's off the mark. And a rebound by Radford, the best 6'2 rebounder in the SEC, maybe in all of college basketball. And a transition three is off the mark. Livingston pulls it down. Oscar running the floor, and he's cut off by Wade Taylor.
What a tremendous play by Wade Taylor to sprint and get outside that restricted arc and rip Oscar Tshiebwe and run it right up the backside off the turnover. Does Dexter Dennis.
2+ minutes before we see our first bucket tonight.
We have not seen an Oscar Tshiebwe touch at that mid-low post area. Expect the double team to come quickly on the first.
Wallace for three. That's off the mark. And another rebound. This one for Henry Coleman, who started his college career playing for Mike Krzyzewski at Duke. Kentucky, as you mentioned, has been wildly efficient on the defensive end the last couple of games, and now a blocking foul. What was the biggest change Kentucky made on the defensive side under John Calipari?
Well, I think what Cal has done, he's backed his defense up a little bit. They've become a physical three-point line and in defensive ball club. Now, the size that he has on the floor, I think, has something to do with it as well, with Wheeler now coming off the bench. Offensively, you're seeing a lot more length and a lot more traffic to work through when you're playing against Kentucky.
Four Final Fours in his first six seasons as Kentucky's head coach. Taylor's able to get it inside to Coleman, and the ball fake got Toppin in the air.
Yeah, just enough of a ball fake to kind of freeze Toppin on the ground. A&M is so good getting that ball to the paint, Tom, either off the bounce or off the pass. They are quick with their screening action, aggressive on both ends of the floor, just like their head coach's mentality 24-7.
AP SEC Coach of the Year a couple of years ago. Buzz's team had a great finish to last season, but nine of their wins were quad four wins, and they just missed out on the NCAA tournament. They used that motivation, the chip on the shoulder, to make a run to the NIT championship game. Here's Cason Wallace for three.
Got to make him. Tshiebwe had three guys on him on the catch.
There's the first make of the game for Kentucky. It comes from C.J. Frederick, and he's talking trash to the A&M bench.
Yeah, the A&M bench is probably saying something to him as well. He only made one three-pointer in here on Tuesday night. It was a big one. But he is on the floor to knock down threes.
I don't know if that's a bear I'd want to poke.
No.
Kentucky brought the double on the post. Dennis down the lane. Nice nifty move with the left.
Man, he is such an aggressive guy. He excelled at the things that don't show up in a box score a couple of weeks ago. Now starting to translate to things that do. Bad pass, going to go ahead and shoot it. Very difficult to shoot a ball in rhythm when it's thrown below your knees.
Second charge picked up by the Cats. That one, Frederick, and he is slow to get to his feet. We've got a low-scoring affair here at Rupp Arena. And when we return, we'll take a look at the historical significance of what Oscar Tshiebwe did Tuesday night against the Bulldogs. Game numbers from Oscar Tshiebwe, but he took it to another level Tuesday against Georgia. 37 points, 24 rebounds. He went 12 of 20 from the field. Oh, he also had three steals in 39 minutes. So when has this been done before? That's some elite company.
And look at those names right there. Bryce Johnson, Blake Griffin, Kevin Durant, and Oscar Tshiebwe was phenomenal on Tuesday. You know, Calipari called him out earlier in the week about not being in the gym like he was last year, and Tshiebwe more than answered that call. And that challenge, this Kentucky team can still go deep in March, but Oscar Tshiebwe has to be Oscar Tshiebwe with an edge every single night. The game will look different today for Oscar because of the single coverage that Georgia threw at him is now out the window. Texas A&M is going to double team and triple him when he catches the ball. And interesting, already in this game, when Kentucky shoots, Texas A&M is running a second guy right at Oscar Tshiebwe. Therefore, another Kentucky perimeter player has a free run to the rim to get on the offensive glass.
Meanwhile, Kentucky coming out of the timeout will counter with the most efficient five-man lineup in all of college basketball. Small sample size, admittedly, but with Frederick and Reeves as the shooters and Wallace running the point. Reeves just into the game, and he'll fire his first chance and got it.
You have to find the backside, Tom, in your press breaker like Kentucky just did. The pressure was intense. The heat was turned up. You've got to punch that heat, burn it off, and find a backside bomb just like Kentucky.
Jimmy, what makes this five-man lineup so interesting as that three goes for Andre Gordon just in the game is how good they are on the defensive end as well.
Well, they've come back to their old school three-on-three defensive breakdowns over at the Kraft Center. Look at the difference. The first four games in conference play to the last two, as that dunker spot is always a threat for Kentucky. But, man, look at the difference in points per 100 possessions over the last two ball games. That's where Kentucky, to me, has flipped their season.
Dennis trying to find some room. And back out to Wade Taylor. A&M has made 4 of 6 from the floor to start this game. Battle inside with Marble and Shibwa. Marble's got nowhere to go. Great on-ball defense. Shot clock at 2. Taylor's going to have to fire, and he didn't notice it.
Now, one bounce too many out of Wade Taylor. And think about how good Texas A&M has been under Buzz to start conference play. They're 5-0, and they have trailed for a combined 5 minutes and 25 seconds in that 5-0 start.
Anderson Garcia, excuse me, Mississippi State transfer, enters for Marble. Yeah, only trailing for 5:25. It's been a dominating run. Here's Reeves again. And Dennis with the board.
But you have to shoot it. You got to shoot it. You got to put pressure and make A&M think about, are we going to continue to extend our defense?
Shibway with the rebound after nobody picked up Taylor. Had an open look. Wallace finds Toppin. A little shovel pass and a finish by Reeves.
A&M wants to sideline influence the ball. They opened up their hips, which allowed the initial drive. And another hard, violent cut out of the corner for Kentucky. And now Texas A&M playing from behind.
I'm not used to that in conference play, including Wednesday's win against Florida when they held the Gators to just 12 points in the first half. Late shot clock again. Hurried three, Dennis. And Frederick finds the board. What have you seen from a tempo difference in Kentucky when they were struggling versus where they are now?
Well, they still want to push it and make it a horse race in their first 8 seconds. And this is what I'm talking about. You open up the hips and let Casey Wallace get downhill and you get a play out of the corner. But defensively is where they've really locked in. They've slowed the game down by their defensive performance. And just look at the length on the floor right now for Kentucky. Taking away your vision. You're having to play 5-on-5 with your eyes if you're A&M.
In and out off of Wallace. Lance Ware in for Shibway right now. He'll stay with Kentucky.
You got two guys on the floor in Frederick and Reeves that had combined for almost 300 career-made threes between the two of them. So that offense now has really stretched out, allow operating room for drives.
And on the drive, Wade Taylor picks up the foul. That's his first. A&M already playing with Boots Radford on the bench, who picked up his second at the 15:51 mark.
Tom, Texas A&M is allowing an average of 20 points in the first half through their 5 SEC games.
That'll win you a lot of them.
Yeah, it will.
Reeves off the mark. A&M's offense has gotten going late the last few possessions. They're shooting 50% from the floor to start this game. Garcia got deep and is able to convert on top of it.
Yeah, I can't have much. It's a simple play. You throw the ball to the elbow. All the action on the other side of the floor is just to kind of distract that weak side defense. Allows a one-on-one move.
A window dressing, huh?
Yeah, absolutely it was.
Ware returns a favor. He got deep. Misses at the rim. And the loose ball picked up by Texas A&M.
And the ones that you absolutely have to make.
Dump inside, denied by Toppin. Chance for the Cats to run. A transition D by A&M. Here's Reeves. What makes A&M so good on the defensive end?
Mismatch, and Toppin recognize it. First of all, just jump up over the top of a mismatch. What A&M is really good at, when you attack them off the bounce, they attack you with multiple bodies, and they're really good at rotating out of their action. And it's, they draw a lot of charges. They make you play through traffic probably as well as anybody in this league.
Intercepted by C.J. Frederick. 4-on-2 for Kentucky. Wallace, the lob, and Reeves late getting there. Frederick lets it fly. C.J. Frederick was looking for a foul after that shot. A&M scored 54 points in their win against Florida on Wednesday. Their fewest points in an SEC win. Here's Taylor now for his first bucket.
Tom, that was really good action in the secondary break by Texas A&M. Kind of a double stack, almost a quick Spain action for Wade Taylor to work off of. Really well done letting turn the corner and get downhill.
There's a mismatch again. Toppin working on Gordon, who had fallen down immediately, and now Toppin lost the dribble.
Let's go back to A&M's last basket. In the transition push, they put pressure on the defense early with this little stack screening action, a little bit of a butt screen and a front-facing screen. Taylor reads it well. Well done.
Challenge gets going, and it's highlighted, of course, by Kansas and Kentucky. Now, Bill Self's team has its hands full with TCU right now. TCU scored 48 points on him in the first half. Third most in the Self era last year. Kentucky put 51 on Kansas in the first half in Lawrence. That was a huge win. And Jimmy, I think that a lot of times we, given Kentucky's struggles this year, we forget about the fact that they were an elite team last year going into the postseason.
Kentucky was.
Yeah.
Yeah, just got a bad mismatch against St. Peter's. Didn't play well enough to win their game, but Kansas has a knack, they've shown, to come back on their home floor.
They're down 15 late to TCU. Here's Marble working on Ware. And Shiba with the rebound. Interesting lineup with both Shiba and Ware in at the same time. Sabir Wheeler on the floor for the first time for the Cats. Wheeler playing in his 104th college game. He's got 85 starts under his belt.
A&M will go under every ball screen on Sabir Wheeler to continue to try to put more bodies around Oscar Shiba to work through.
Mason Wallace was wide open. Gordon with the ball fake, got Sabir Wheeler in the air. Shot clock at 10. Garcia tried to go up and under, and Ware D'd him up.
Good discipline by Ware, right? Throw up a big long wall at the rim.
That's struggling from deep. They're only making back-to-back with Reeves and Frederick. They're now 2-for-10 from three.
Yeah, Shiba so good at reading the ball in flight and finding the backside of the rim.
Oscar, your jumper. And save on the baseline by Kason Wallace. Tomorrow, women's basketball's on the SEC Network. Kentucky will be on the road in Starkville to take on Mississippi State, followed by Georgia and Texas A&M at 3 o'clock Eastern. Anderson Garcia committed the foul, his first.
That was a big second foul that Hooch Radford picked up for Buzz Williams. Probably have to go the rest of the half without the pulse of their program on the floor. Hooch Radford is as tough as any guard in the country. Both ends of the floor.
Hand off to Reeves, and he gets it. Second three of the game for Antonio Reeves.
And A&M is normally so good at having contact on their assignment before the ball is handed out of bounds. And that time just lost track of Reeves.
Gordon switched on to Shiba now. Coleman in the paint. And Lance Ware hauls it in. Sabir Wheeler will push. Out to Chris Livingston. Good.
Really good find by Wheeler. I mean, Wheeler's the kind of guy that can come in and bust the game open for Kentucky or bust a pipe. And when he plays off at 2 feet and finds the backside as a passer, and Livingston, money pass, makes him pay.
Largest lead of the game for the Cats, and then a foul by Wheeler trying to fight over the screen and colliding with Taylor.
A&M is so good at getting contact out of bounds under. Reeves is the passer on the inbounds, and now they just lose him. They lose contact. He just wins the foot race to the ball, and Ware just kind of seals off and hands it to him. Now watch Wheeler spin, get to the paint, jump off 2 feet, pass on the money. Nothing but bottom from Livingston.
Wheeler leading the SEC in assists per game this season, as he had the previous two. Taylor floater, that's good over Oscar.
Yeah, Taylor just works Wheeler off of a ball screen, and Wheeler got hung up on it. Wheeler is one of the better guards in this league, Tom, at making tough twos with that floater in the mid-range game.
Here's Livingston, another three, and he strokes it in.
Why not? The Texas A&M is so aggressive coming at the basketball. When you punch the paint, you've got to find the backside of the defense, and Kentucky has found it two or three times.
Chris Livingston was only 1 for 9 from three in conference play. He's knocked down both of his attempts from deep in this one. Heppner had it stripped away. Reeves finds it. Chance to push. Where to Reeves? And it's ripped down by Henry Coleman III. And then a second foul on Shibwe.
How can Oscar Shibwe allow that to happen? He had plenty of room to sprint and be in position. That was not an aggressive push by A&M, and now a costly second foul on Shibwe. Look at Shibwe. That's just not aggressive, not intense. A lazy second costly foul on Big O.
Well, welcome back. This is a Texas A&M team that started the season just 6-5, but then they got in conference play and they found their stride. Goes back to last year. They finished strong. They won 9 straight regular season SEC games. And Jimmy, they seem to have found their rhythm, especially with this starting five that's been so good.
Well, what I love about Texas A&M, Tom, they are tight and protective of their inner circle. They keep the noise out of their team and their inner circle, as well as any team that I know, talking to Buzz as well as I know him. And you keep the distractions out of your team, you can stumble out of the gate a little bit and still believe in how we play. And Texas A&M has done a tremendous job of that. And what's hurt them so far in this game, they are shooting 50% from the floor, but they've only taken 14 shots compared to Kentucky's 23 because of 7 turnovers by the Aggies. Maybe part of that without boots on the floor to take care of the basketball, but they have got to hang on to that thing right now on the road.
Julius Marble, the transfer from Michigan State, has been a key for them in conference play. He's averaging 15-5 in the 5 SEC games. That's his first point of the game. 3 years playing for Tom Izzo in East Lansing. And he rattles them both home. Xavier Wheeler will run the point. In another world, Xavier Wheeler would be wearing an Aggie uniform tonight. He signed with Billy Kennedy out of high school in Houston, out of Houston Christian. That was a recruiting class that also included Kobe Brown of Missouri. But when Billy Kennedy was let go and Buzz came in, those two guys both left to go elsewhere. And Xavier first, Georgia with Tom Crean, and now Kentucky in his second year.
And a lot of no-purpose dribbling by Kentucky on this possession. They're left with very little with 4 on the shot clock. The ball did not deserve to go in that time for Kentucky because of the lack of offense. There will be no back down by Dexter Dennis or Livingston, either one. I mean, both these teams come in today, Tom, with a lot of juice, a lot of heat on them to keep their momentum going forward. But that was a poor offense possession by Kentucky. And I coached here with Eddie Sutton back in the day, and one of the film assignments that I had is two guys just fighting like you're supposed to fight, getting towards late January. But Eddie Sutton, one of my jobs as a coach, Tom, he wanted to know how many dribbles per possession with relation to the personnel that we have on the floor.
Yep.
And John Calipari wants the same thing right now from his guys. He talked to him today. I want that ball moving and popping. That's when we're at their best. And Xavier Wheeler that time over dribbled a little bit. The ball got stuck. And those are the possessions Kentucky has to eliminate going forward.
Well, this officiating crew is going to take a look at that and see if there's anything flagrant involved. And you can understand the fight for both, who have had their ups and downs as programs this season. Jimmy, I think that's just a basketball play, although Livingston's elbow may have made contact with Dennis's chin. So you think about that battle and this battle on the floor between the two teams and what's available, what's on the line. Remember, A&M just barely missed the NCAA tournament last year. And as of today, both Kentucky and Texas A&M are among Lenardi's first four out.
Well, what's hurting A&M as much as anything, eight of their wins are against quad four. That does not help your resume. Yeah, Kentucky has just struggled to start conference play. They got a huge win at Tennessee, which everybody feels like has kind of got them back on the national map. Can they keep it going right now on their home floor? This is danger.
Livingston. I thought Cowell's going to make the save. Back in his playing days, huh? It would have been face guarding in the NFL, but it's out of bounds off of Kentucky, off of Chris Livingston. A&M trying to figure things out. 50% from the floor, as you mentioned, but the turnovers, seven of them, limited their opportunities. Bowman's only shot 1-3 this season. That's not in his bag, but the drive is.
Well, he's made a couple of tough ones, has he not? Because Kentucky, Onyesu did a good job of keeping him squared up, kept his hips on the ball. Just a tougher shot over good defense.
Toppin works it into Onyesu. There's that post double and trying to get it out. He nearly threw it away. And Wheeler does, and now Coleman running the floor with the jam. We're tied at 21, and it came off of A&M's double down defense.
They call it monster, which goes all the way back to the days of Rick Majerus, who made that term awfully popular with coaches. Monster the ball on a low block touch, and this time the monster comes low. Onyesu gets rattled and throws it away, and Wheeler has nothing he can do but just try to save it, and the Aggies right back in it. Monster defense as this ball gets thrown to Onyesu. Look right here, you're coming on the low side, and Onyenso's not ready for it. All of a sudden, bam, he pivots right into traffic. They dig down, three on the ball, and they force a costly turnover. Really well done by Texas A&M.
If Kentucky identifies it, how can they beat it?
Well, they need to move Kentucky, their low post touch, up the lane to a mid post touch and give them some room to operate. The further the ball gets away from the rim, the more difficult it is to track.
Sheway on the bench with two personal fouls. And Lance Ware at the five right now.
Head tap, ball screen for Wheeler.
Frederick back to Toppin, shot clock at two. Toppin's going to have to rise. Great defense as it was knocked away by Wade Taylor.
And Tom, nothing gives you more juice as an opposing team to come on someone's home floor and deliver a knockout on the defensive end. You talk about guys down in a stance and aggressive, seeing ball you man, just refusing to let the ball get inside, delete the drive. You've done your job if you're Aggies on that possession. Very well done.
A&M on a 6-0 run right now. And the Cats have turned it over three times in the last 220. Coleman. Another drive and another finish.
Now here's the problem with Kentucky defensively. They're backing their defense off a little bit, shrinking, but it's allowing the bigs to get some momentum coming downhill. Tough Top shot.
On the mid-range.
You like that shot?
I like it when it's coming from him sometimes. Tied at 23 now. Top and perfect 3-for-3 from the floor. That is a battle inside with Ware and Marble. Jump hook. Wow, those post guys are having their way inside.
And Marble can go either way with a jump hook. He can go to his right shoulder with his left paw or left shoulder with his right paw. Turnovers now starting to mount a little bit.
And the Aggies have made six straight. It's Marble again.
If you're a Kentucky big, how did you get outran down the floor and put Wheeler in a bad mismatch at the rim?
12-2 A&M run.
A lack of effort by Kentucky in their transition defense.
And that lack of effort getting back from Sheboy is what put him on the bench to begin with his second personal foul. Jason Wallace for three. Kentucky, 5-of-14 from deep. Again, they got beat down the floor.
That's a timeout for sure by John Calipari. He sees the same thing, and I've seen the last two plays. The Kentucky bigs have been outworked. And that's one of the strengths that Texas A&M brings to any basketball game. They have tremendous belief in heart and toughness. And this is the first one. That's a mismatch by Wheeler. Not so much his fault. Not a lot of fight by him either. But where's the big? And there's the back possessions. The bigs of A&M wearing Kentucky out. question. When Shibuya went out with foul trouble, this game flipped. So you're now missing your low post score. And Buzz Williams continues to come with the monster just to make sure that Cal can't get going on that low block. But the significance of Shibuya out, those two bigs, Coleman and Marble, 16 points combined. Try to throw the lob, and A&M sniffs it out.
Frederick little floater left it short. Aggressive rebound by Dexter Dennis.
You make Frederick bounce it into his shot, you've done your job if you're Texas A&M.
Ball pressure by Wallace forces the turnover. Reeves has Ware. He'll fire on a zone, and he knocks it down.
You have to stay aggressive if you're Kentucky. Your inside scoring's not there. Antonio Reeves just with a dead sprint to that high slot in transition.
Marble with a little jump hook. The bigs, Marble and Coleman, had scored the last 14 during what was a 14-2 run for A&M. Toppin left wide open. And he makes his first three. That's only his third three in conference play. Kentucky's already tied its most threes in the first half of the season. It previously hit seven against North Florida. Marble skips it. Dennis got it. And then Ware with the rejection. Now Coleman, he gets stripped. Cats looking for the lead. Ware all alone. And he gets fouled by Julius Marble.
Jacob Toppin, to your point, only two out of three from the three-point line in conference play coming in. But Kentucky runs a little play to kind of get him to snap out, and Texas A&M just dares him to take one. And Lance Ware now has changed his energy since the last timeout. He went on a dead sprint the first trip down after the timeout in transition defense. Impacting the game right now with toughness and speed.
Ware's got another one coming. It's a big Monday doubleheader on ESPN. Duke just got a win this afternoon at home at Cameron. They take on Virginia Tech with a trip to Blacksburg at 7 Eastern, followed by number 2 Kansas and 21st ranked Baylor at 9 p.m.
Man, a Kentucky fan asked me before the ball game, who's the best team you've seen? Who's the best team in the country? I talked about Purdue, I talked about Kansas. I said, and as you guys know, Alabama is the best team. Shook their head and went on.
You saw firsthand down at Coleman Coliseum. A travel by Wade Taylor, the fourth.
A&M continues to be very aggressive, though, Tom, the first 8 seconds of the possession. Aggressive off the bounce, aggressive throwing it inside.
10 turnovers for Buzz Williams' team here in the first half. They average fewer than 13 a game. Taylor comes out on top of this time.
It's a double stack, dive, pop, the top and being the pop guy.
He brought the double to him. Wallace finds Frederick.
Man, that's good recognition, though, by Wallace to know that Frederick was waiting on the backside. A great feel by the freshman point guard.
Frederick just 1-for-4 from three. The Cats have nailed 7 threes in the first half, though. Here's Coleman on Ware. This has been a weapon for A&M. Trying to get some space, yeah, and it's another A&M turnover. Coleman's second personal foul.
And the last 3 minutes by Lance Ware have been tremendous. As he's put in a spot right now, guarding these bigs of Texas A&M, but he holds his ground, doesn't take the ball fake. Keeps his foundation solid on the floor. 55 in white, a good 3-minute stretch right now for Calipari.
Ware started the first 4 games of the season when Oscar Shibuya was out with his knee injury following surgery. Shibuya's been sitting for a good chunk of this half. Remember, he picked up a foul about 10 seconds into the game. And a baseline play on the offensive side. Frederick again continues to struggle from deep. He was just 1-for-5 in that Georgia win.
And the ones you got to make. I know that shooting finger is still heavily bandaged. Probably bothering his release a little bit. And Buzz is going to take a timeout. It feels like the tempo of the game, the tractor pull, mud, running in mud, favors the Aggies early.
continues tonight. The round of 16 comes your way at 8 o'clock Eastern on ESPN2. All course coverage starts at 7 p.m. on ESPN Plus. Coco Gauff still alive. America's J.J. Wolf and Tommy Paul on the men's side. 35-year-old Andy Murray saw his fairy tale run come to an end overnight. A run he put together. He's on the court for nearly 6 hours a few nights ago. You said playing in the mud is advantage Texas A&M. They've proven they can win low-scoring games.
Well, yeah, absolutely, and especially on the road in Rupp. You don't want to get this thing going in a track meet and get the crowd involved. The Aggies have won 3 of their 5 conference games, 2 of them being in the 60s, 1 of them in the 50s. They are comfortable and confident when the game is hard and playing hard on the road, controlling the tempo, battling on the boards. Now, this is one area that Kentucky's been good at, Tom, today so far. That's only their 15th foul. Texas A&M right there at the best in the country at the number of times they get to the free throw line.
Third in the country in makes, 6th in the country in attempts. And Boots Radford, back on the floor playing with 2 fouls, goes to the free throw line. Radford is 3rd in the league in free throws made. He knocks out another one here. That's a first point for the Baton Rouge native. Originally showed up in Blacksburg via a bus. Took the Greyhound from Baton Rouge to Blacksburg to play for Buzz Williams. And he's sporting a new look. Cut off the dreads a couple of games ago. Going with the headband. He's got 2 free throws.
Well, he cut his hair to join the battle that his former academic advisor at Virginia Tech, Elise Sevilla, is going through, a battle with cancer. And cut off his hair a couple of weeks ago in support for her. A great relationship, huge heart out of that kid.
Yeah, a lot of time they spent together trying to get his grades right. He was with Elise 6 days a week, 2 hours a day. Put in the work. Here's Wallace now with the dish. Swinging all the way back into the corner. Frederick gives it up. Shot clock at 2. Reeves. No. And Taupin cleans it up, but couldn't finish.
And the defensive rotation by the Aggies that time was exceptional.
Dennis transition 3. Tried to will it in. And a near save, and he goes crashing into the Kentucky coaches, right? Between KT Turner and Orlando Antigua. Not a soft landing spot over on KT's side.
Tom, the overall team motor for Texas A&M is exceptional. Dexter Dennis, former defensive player of the year at Wichita State in that league. I talked about him earlier. He excelled at the things that don't show up on a box score for about a month. But now he's starting to really, the best rebounder in the SEC right now. 9.6 a game in SEC games. He's right there at the top of the league.
Cal kind of stole the timeout right there, called out an offensive set. Buzz was only standing about 20 feet from him and answered with a defensive call. I mean, it's like football OC seeing a formation and the defense responding.
This is a lob play for Taupin typically in that box set, kind of getting free on the backside. And again, A&M sniffs it out.
Frederick for 3. Ware was held on the rebound. It will stay with the Cats. The shot clock is off. There's 6.1 left in the half.
Kentucky doesn't really have that break you down guard now in late clock situation.
Clock at 2 now. Topping for 3. Off the mark. And nothing doing for Kentucky on that last possession. This one, as you said, is a tractor pull. And they're doing it without their biggest rig. Shibwe against Georgia went 37-24 today. Scoreless, 3 rebounds and only 10 minutes of play thanks to a couple of personal fouls. 2-point game at the half. Let's get you back to the studio. Welcome back to Rupp Arena and the SEC on ESPN. Firecrackers in the house. That was about as lively as we saw here in the first half at Rupp, because the tractor pull has A&M in front by a 31-29 score at the half. With that, we welcome you back courtside. Tom Hart alongside Jimmy Dykes. Jimmy, this Texas A&M team is built on its defense, and they were fantastic in the first half.
Yeah, they were. That's how they've hung in this ball game. They haven't shot the ball great themselves, but what they've done defensively is they scored off their defense to the tune of, they have 10 fast break points. Kentucky only has 3. There's about a 90-second stretch there that I think A&M decided, you know, we're going to make Kentucky pay for the lack of transition defense. First of all, it was Wheeler got in a mismatch because no big ran back to protect the rim. Then off of a turnover, another big gets out in front and runs. And that combination of Henry Coleman and Marble in transition to the half court is where the majority of the scoring has come with from the Aggies. A big part of this game is Texas A&M's defense. As you look at the game summary, right down here, Kentucky has taken 21 three-point shots in this game. And to only two, from the two-point, only 15 shots. That's out of balance for Kentucky, Tom. Kentucky came in averaging only 17 three-point attempts per game in SEC play. They've already taken 21. Texas A&M not letting anything get going inside that three-point line. A bulldog tough defensive sharks right now from College Station.
Reigning National Player of the Year Oscar Tshiebwe held scoreless in a half for the first time since the Alabama game earlier in conference play. And those A&M bigs went on a run with Tshiebwe on the bench in foul trouble, a 14-2 run. Livingston off the cut, can't corral it. A&M has a chance to push. Great hands by Kaysen Wallace. Foul trouble for A&M. Had Boots Radford on the bench for a good chunk of the first half, but obviously he's back out there to start the second.
Now the 12th turnover for A&M in this game. Frederick just cannot make a shot. And those are wide open good looks.
Toppin loves that baseline jumper. And that's the second one he's hit.
Well, he knows that Texas A&M is going to run at him. And that's a charge waiting to happen. Toppin just surveys the play, surveys the defense, jumps up over the top.
Marble and Coleman combined for 16 in the first half for A&M. The majority of those coming on that one run when Tshiebwe just left the game. Oscar tracks down the rebound.
Slow developing double drag for Kentucky in their offense, trying to get Wallace to his left.
Hands off to Livingston. No whistle on that contest. And now Frederick for three. Got it. Needed that one. Hit his first and missed all of them in between.
Yeah, but again, get it and shoot it with confidence. That's why you're on the floor. You came into Kentucky as one of the best three-point shooters in the transfer portal last year.
Jimmy, I asked him about that finger that's taped up, the ring finger on his right hand, on his shooting hand, and he said it doesn't bother me at all, but you would imagine that have to affect a shooter. Everything's so finely tuned.
Yes, because I believe that finger that he had the problems with is the last finger to touch the ball on the release. Either way, it's one of the last two fingers. It has to affect your feel on the ball, but if you're Frederick, you got to keep shooting. You got to shoot this thing with confidence. You've only made, what, two out of your last 13 or 14, but shoot it like you've made eight out of your last 14.
It's just 1-for-5 against Georgia, now 2-for-8 behind the line tonight. Here's Dexter Dennis to the free throw line. Coming off of a double-double against Florida, 11 points and 16 rebounds. It was the most rebounds in an SEC game for an Aggie since Robert Williams, now in the NBA, had 17 against Missouri.
Well, his value to the team is backed up by his minutes played. And you watch A&M, Buzz Williams will always keep either Boots Radford or Dexter Dennis on the floor. He's never playing without one of those guys on the floor. And then Buzz will put three go-get guys, which three rebounders and always a couple of ball handlers. That's just kind of the DNA of how he sees the game, talking about Buzz Williams.
Frederick looking for Tshiebwe. They're sinking on the Kentucky big. Wallace in the paint.
And to your point, Tshiebwe is being defended by a guy and a half before he catches the ball. And then a second and third defender is going to come anytime he gets it. As a result, somebody else has to drive the ball and make a play.
Wallace was 7-for-11 against Georgia, just 1-for-8 today. Radford got a half step on him. Tshiebwe's playing with two fouls. Challenge a shot, but Radford finished.
He is tough as a boot, as his name is. You talked about earlier, he's the nation's best offensive rebounder for 6'2 and under. He and Posh Alexander for St. John's are tied. Careful.
Oscar leapt to his feet after being bounced to the floor by Marble. It's a second on Marble. And was it Marble who got teed up? That would be my assumption.
Great job by Toppin to sprint to Shibue and shove him back. And make sure Shibue doesn't get stuck with the tee as well. Yeah, that's a shove by Marble. That's going to escalate, I think, to an F1. Unnecessary contact, but a great job by Toppin to sprint and take Shibue out of what could have possibly compounded the problem.
Marble tried to show that he took an elbow around the nose, but Oscar's just shrugging it off. Working on his chewing gum. Jimmy just talked with Courtney Green, SEC official. What are they looking at?
Yeah, Tom, we're looking at a lot. First of all, they're going to look at potential contact as the play was flowing up the floor. Marble maybe feeling like that he had got hit on the way up the floor, which you go back now and look and check that part of the play. But then at the end, obviously the shove by Marble and what transpired after that. So they're going to break this play down in a couple of different sections. Was there anything happening on the initial push up the floor with unnecessary contact? And then you got to clean up the end of the play as well.
And it seems like the end of the play would be a flagrant, the key being the fact that the shove came with Oscar in the air.
Yeah.
You shove a guy while he's got both feet off the ground. But here's old secrets. Watch both 34s, maroon and white. Oscar got the elbow.
That could escalate to an F2. You don't want to judge intent, but Oscar clearly knew he was throwing that elbow on the way up the floor.
I tell you what, it's probably still a flagrant on Marble at the other end, but you certainly understand where the shove came from now after seeing what Oscar delivered near midcourt.
It was a really good catch. It was brought to the official's attention. I mean, Marble was quick to say, I know I got shoved or I shoved at the end, but go back and look why. I mean, that could be severe or extreme contact right here by Shibue looking right at him. I mean, the open hand is what hits him. The elbow comes through. Well, I'll be shocked if that's not at least an F1 on Shibue.
Gotta be an F1.
That's the definition of the rule.
What raises it to an F2 and an ejection?
Well, that severe extreme is how severe the contact was the player in a airborne, unprotected spot on the play as well, which he was not. But I think there's a discussion right here. You look at wide, 34 in white. He turns and looks, and right there. That's clearly an F1 that could be escalated to an F2.
I'd like to know, since we have time, what brought that about from Oscar, if you take it back even 10 seconds further and under the basket.
Well, it might be. I'm 0 for 1 from the field. I only have 5 rebounds in the game, and I had to sit in the first half with foul trouble, so some frustration by Shibue. But either way, that play running up the floor.
So the difference between flagrant one and flagrant true, here's, you mentioned excessive, severe, or extreme, and have to be a live ball, could be a dead ball situation. I don't know if it was brutal, dangerous, or abusive, but the severity of the contact to head, and the injury potential while the player is vulnerable, that's usually in the air. That doesn't necessarily apply. What do you think now, seeing the definition in writing of flagrant two?
Well, the severity of the contact isn't going to come into play because he didn't. Fortunately, he didn't connect with the initial elbow. It was the open hand that got him. So the contact wasn't all that hard. I know you don't like to get hit in the face, but the fact that he kind of sized the guy up and knew exactly what he was doing with that left arm, elbow, hand area.
It is really rare to see a flagrant two. I can't remember the last time I saw a flagrant two.
But normally it's a fist, it's a punch thrown.
Yeah.
It's a guy's in the air and you come in from behind, not even making a basketball play, and wind up on someone's block shot. Doug Shaw's now given an explanation.
Hal is trying to claim that.
I think they're going to stay with. I think they're going to stay with an F1 on Oscar. You know, there wasn't a punch thrown. There wasn't anything with a severe contact.
Now remember, there's two parts of it. You think they'd stay with an F1 on marble too?
I think.
Or does that change how they judge marble's action?
Yeah, I think it does not change how they judge marble's action. Those are two separate plays.
A common personal foul issued to number 34 Julius Marble. In addition to that, a dead ball contact foul was issued to Marble as well. For Kentucky, an unobserved flagrant foul was assessed.
The end result of this is both teams with a flagrant one. Both players, I should say.
So dead ball technical fouls on Shibue.
There's the handball.
And right there, that's the F1, Tom, on Shibue running up the floor right there. That's the F1. And at the end of the play are the dead ball contact technical fouls.
And then Marble with the push. Now here's, watch the hold by Marble, which was what John Calipari was claiming. And this was the start of it. 34 pulls on Oscar's left arm. His reaction is to respond with a chicken wing to the face. And then it continued all the way down the floor. And we got a lot to sort out. And the home crowd here at Rupp is not happy about it. It's a 1-point lead right now. That would be two fouls, by the way, on Julius Marble, which gives him three. And that'll be a third personal foul on Oscar Shibue. So Marble's got three and Oscar's got three, and we'll have Marble shooting a dead ball technical on one side. What can you clean up for us?
Well, plus it was an unobserved in live play. They go back and see it on film, an F1 assessed to Oscar Shibue. And then 34 in red was assessed with the common foul and a dead ball technical foul.
And Jimmy, of all of that, a Marble has three personal fouls. That's one thing. But Oscar had to sit for a good chunk of the first half with two. Now has three, and he still hasn't scored a point for Kentucky. You leave him in with three?
I think
three minutes in the half.
Cal has got to get a conversation with assistant coaches right now, and assistant coaches have to make sure Cal understands that's his third. And then Cal has to trust his gut. What does he want to do with Shibue?
So
I would put Frederick at the free throw line, right?
Yeah, so Frederick will shoot the technical, and then Oscar will shoot the foul from the personal foul. Frederick, 14 of 16 from the free throw line this year.
I don't see any movement by Calipari to get Oscar Shibue out of the game. He's going to trust Shibue to play with three personal fouls. Shibue has... He's been frustrated in this game. You can see it. He's got to get his emotions back in check and not now pick up what would be a very costly fourth foul in the next couple of minutes.
Is we're not shooting free throws on the other foul, on the common foul?
I'm sorry?
Are we not shooting free throws on the common foul? Oscar was shooting, I thought.
No. I think they said he's on the ground. I'm with you. I thought the same thing, but...
So play on, and little floater by Cason Wallace. It's only his second make of the game. Kentucky by three. Home crowd into it here in Rupp after all the shenanigans.
The kid with the ball, Boots Radford, is your go-to scorer. He and Dennis are guys that have been good offensively. And Livingston, again, a really good job, Tom. A little bit of side influence to keep Dennis from getting to the paint.
C.J. Frederick tried to sell that call on one side. It's reversed on the other. It looked like the ball after the carom went off of Livingston's leg. Right there is right knee.
And a great find by Courtney Green on the far side of the play to see it and come in and correct it.
Fantastic work by this crew. They've had to sleuth their way through those replays. And as much as the Kentucky fans disagree with it, when they see a replay, they'll understand. Maybe the why, if not appreciated. Shibue with the rebound.
Gonna go elbow for Toppin or Shibue on an elbow touch. Aiden pushes the touch out a little higher. Pin down for Frederick.
Toppin in that mid-range. Livingston can't throw down the follow.
But he had a free rim to run to, because that second defender that time was also coming over on Toppin in case he got to that low block.
Dennis fouled by Livingston. It's a second on Chris Livingston. Kentucky will have its most efficient lineup on the floor when we return. But to get to that point, a little back alley brawl between the two bigs. Marble puts Shibwe on his backside, and we play on in Lexington. January 28th between the two, and these two conferences loaded with top 25 teams, and perhaps the upset of the day in college basketball, not just the result, but where it happened. TCU won at Allen Fieldhouse and blew Kansas out 83-60. Held the Jayhawks to just 22 points in the second half. Jayhawks have a big Monday game, and then they'll come to Rupp this weekend.
And a huge number for A&M to try to overcome right now, Tom. They have 13 turnovers, the Aggies do, which has equated to 19 fewer shots in the game than Kentucky. Aggies are shooting the high percentage, just not enough attempts.
56% now on Boots Radford driving layup. A&M hasn't extended their defense out into the backcourt as they did in the first half. Kaysen Wallace drains the three.
Got to take the open ones. Wallace 0 for 5 prior to that. Fires one up with confidence. He and Frederick have made big threes the last few minutes.
This lineup is plus 7 on the day. Played very few possessions together in the first half. There's Radford going against Shibwe, who's playing with three.
Continue to go at Shibwe. Put him in ball screens. Drive him. See if he can pick up the fourth. He doesn't want to foul. You'll have some clean looks at the rim if you're A&M.
Wallace, the lob, and Toppin to finish.
It's always a threat for Toppin. He starts in any type of a box set to roll out on the weak side. And Aggies don't get a body on him, and Toppin's going to win the jump contest.
That's a 45-inch vertical. Skip pass, Radford banks it in. Your bank open on a Saturday afternoon?
It is. There's not a lot in there for me to withdraw, but it is open.
That's why you end up eating a Waffle House. Frederick gets it inside, and a quick release by Shibwe.
Well, you have to go quick because Shibwe knows they're double-teaming, triple-teaming me on the catch. No hesitation. Catch it, boom, up, right shoulder, left paw finish.
First points of the night for Shibwe. Radford has scored the last 7 for A&M. Doesn't get a touch here. Garcia misses the follow. Reeves, too strong. Boots is feeling it now. Working on Reeves. Just slipped through.
How slick is he? Looked like he was going to come to a 2-footed jump stop and just stuck that one pivot foot down, and really well done. Finished with that left hand, going away from the basket. Hard shot, looks easy.
He's back on track after struggling offensively the last couple of games. 12 points total. Wallace leaves the layup short. Oscar triple team. Frederick was halfway down and fell out, and then Shibwe had it knocked out of his hands. It'll stay with Kentucky.
Watch Boots Radford. He's a cutter, a driver. He's the heart of the ball club. And Buzz Williams, 3 or 4 times per half, will get a play call to start him on the right side so he can get to his left. And there's that roll around on the backside that Kentucky goes to, at least twice per game for Toppin.
Marble and Shibwe matched up again after their full court scuffle a few minutes ago. Skip. Here's Reeves. And with Oscar lunging, Wade Taylor, the fourth, finds the rebound. Taylor pushes it. Here's Dennis. Blocked by Wallace. Dennis gets it right back, and it'll go to the free throw line. And Toppin took a shot defending Dennis.
And what an aggressive play, though, by Dennis. I know three-point shot gets blocked, but he follows it up and takes it hard into traffic. I mean, his heart and motor for the game is exceptional. And Toppin got hit. You don't want to get hit. A hard blow.
They're going to take a look at this just to make sure it shouldn't be elevated.
Well, what you're looking for now, was it an intentional kick out with a leg or an intentional knee by Dexter Dennis? Really good fly out by Cason Wallace. Bam, goes on the shot side. And then it's a free ball, and Dexter Dennis, nothing intentional. That's, to me, the first look, it's a basketball play, a guy going up. Just an unfortunate spot for Toppin to be in. I don't see how you can say the knee was had any intentionality behind it.
By the way, while we have a break, as they figure this one out, we want to send our best to Tom Minner and his family. He was the general manager of Rupp Arena when it first opened in 1976, and later the CEO before retiring in 2000. He's resting comfortably with his family here in Lexington. I know it means a lot to them and their family, what this building has meant to the community, not just Kentucky men's basketball, but the NCAA tournaments it's hosted, women's basketball tournaments they've hosted over the years. Trying to get more clarification here. This will be a common foul, normal basketball play. It will send Dennis to the free throw line, where he's made 79% of his attempts. Transferred in from Wichita State, he was the American Conference Defensive Player of the Year last year.
Tom, just a normal basketball play, like I thought. You certainly want to check it and see if there is an extended knee on purpose or a leg kick out. I love this kid, Dexter Dennis, at the line right now. He's compliant and he's tough. What do I mean by that? He's compliant. He's a real pleaser for Buzz Williams and that staff. Yes, sir. No, sir. I'll do anything you ask me to do. A lot of times guys that are like that can be a little bit soft. This kid is compliant and tough as nails. Tremendous combination.
Knocks down both free throws. A&M back up by one. A&M perfect from the free throw line. Still well under their average of trips to the line and what they're on pace for. Kind of a matchup man or zone here for A&M. And the entry pass stolen away by Wade Taylor. Here's Boots Radford for three.
Well, all that was A&M. They're in man-to-man defense. They're just switching everything. There wasn't any movement. Made it look like a zone. And an errant pass by Cason Wallace.
Toppin finds the cutting Reeves, and he draws the foul on Henry Coleman. It's a third on the Aggies big.
Tom, if you're not sure what defense you're going against, throw the ball to the nail and get some cutting action going like Kentucky just did. And the Aggies hanging in there like just the Aggies always do. Defense to offense. Boots Radford, tough as nails. Tight one in Lexington.
Well, Texas A&M is on a 7-game win streak, and Boots Radford has been the power behind that. Now the second half, he's been the power behind their offensive comeback.
Well, this kid is shooting 73% on rim shots in SEC play. A phenomenal finisher is Boots Radford. We already talked about he's the best offensive rebounder for a 6'2 guy in the country. Has taken control of this game. He has gotten into the paint. He's got the courage and the stuff and the fortitude to pull up and knock down threes. He's not a tremendous three-point shooter, about 30% on the year, but man, not afraid to take big ones. In foul trouble in the first half. Look at this, 14 in the second half.
And Jimmy, during their 7-game win streak, he's upped his field goal percentage by 12 points. He's upped his three-point percentage by 8 points. He's been a real key for them. Here's Reeves.
Tom, when you're finishing, you're a 6'2 guard.
Yeah.
You're in a physical, tough, two-point defensive team league like the SEC, and you're finishing three out of every four attempts at the rim. Man, that is high-level stuff. Boots Radford is that.
Antonio Reeves, transfer from Illinois State, flashes down both free throws. One possession game, almost midway through the second half.
And almost half of Kentucky's shots in this game have been from the three-point line. 27 three-point attempts for Kentucky. That's 2 minutes.
Marble's entry pass is off the mark and an A&M turnover, the 14th of the game for the Aggies. This Kentucky lineup, from a plus-minus perspective, is only plus one on the effort. Toppin rolls it in.
Really good job by Toppin, because they really pressured Toppin to take away his passing to Shibwe. Read the pressure, burn the pressure off with a couple of bounces into a jump shot. Well done. Oh, that's friendly fire.
Yeah, Aggie on Aggie crime right there, and Marble still down. Toppin on the other end. Nope. Rebound to A&M, and they'll stop play with Julius Marble still on the floor. He was going up for the rebound, and he went face to face with his teammate Coleman.
I'm not sure he knows.
Or was it Dennis? Excuse me.
I'm not sure if he knows he's in Rupp Arena or Coleman Coliseum right now. He took a shot to the head. A really good job by Texas A&M to clean up a rebound. So they were outnumbered 5-on-4. The officials did the right thing to let the play finish, because he was not in jeopardy of having more harm come his way. But as soon as A&M secured the rebound, stopped the action.
By the way, it should be noted that A&M is already without Solomon Washington, who made a game-saving play at the end of their last game against Florida, but is in concussion protocol right now. Didn't make the trip, and that was Dennis colliding with Marble, who immediately heads back to the A&M locker room to get further evaluation. Radford working on Wallace, a great defender, and Wallace gets whistled for the foul.
And Buzz Williams just continues to let Booch Radford, either on the initial push or the half-court sets, are all to get this kid going left. Just a little bit of traffic out front to clear it out. And if you're Casein Wallace, you have got to make Radford beat you going right.
And so here's Radford going to the free throw line. 81% on the season. Knocks down the first. Tomorrow, ACC Women's College Basketball comes your way, as number 20 North Carolina State takes on Louisville, 1 p.m. Eastern on ABC. Radford's got 18 points now to lead all scorers.
And now 12 points from the free throw line for A&M in this ball game. They come in getting 16 points a game from the charity stripe in SEC play.
Having missed from there, taking advantage of the freebies. And a foul out front, charge to Anderson Garcia.
And Tom, if you're Toppin, you have to drive that pressure that they're putting on him as a high-low passer to Shibwe. You can't just let it eat you up. You got to burn it off by being aggressive, just like Toppin did.
If Marble can't return to this game, it changes what A&M was doing with their front line with Marble and Coleman in a big way. And I got to go to Garcia in there. Shibwe doubled. Garcia came over from the bottom. Wheeler trap. It'll stay with Kentucky, only 5 seconds on the shot clock. Where'd he go quickly here?
Shibwe was double before he ever caught the ball, by the way. Talk about a fast, purposeful double team. Now, can you get Toppin loose by throwing one at the front of the rim, letting out jump people? It's not a real big Texas A&M squad. Your A&M get body on body right now and not allow a run for Toppin, who's going to take it out.
That's an awkward point to get it in. Reeves shakes with three. Found the rim, but that's it. A little bit surprised Dennis wasn't shaken up at all after that collision with Marble. He seemed to be okay coming out of there. Garcia into Toppin. That's an offensive foul.
Good job by Toppin to keep his hips and his head in front of the ball. That's a legal play by Toppin. You don't have to be squared up in front of him. He's guarding legally. As that drive occurs, Tom, the official's eyes go to the defender and then read where the contact initiated from. An easy call offensively.
Garcia sits with his third. Coleman and Marble also have three apiece. Trying to go high low, top and find Shibway after the dribble. And he converts it, has a chance for three.
That was, again, was just switching man-to-man defense by A&M. Resembles a zone. John Calipari gets Jacob Toppin at the nail. And that weak side rotation for the Aggies a little bit late. And Shibway makes him pay. Wade Taylor, number four, just hesitated a little bit. Maybe Shibway gets away with a walk, but regardless, 34 with a chance for an and one.
Toppin tracked it down, and then they went out of bounds.
Did Hefner not push Toppin in the back on the way to the ball?
You're the only one that saw it. Everybody sitting behind us saw the same thing.
Watch right here. It looked like, out of the corner of my eye, there was enough contact there to cause Toppin to fly out of bounds. Man, it's a heavy hitting game, is it not?
It is indeed. But Hefner saved himself. That universal sign pulling the hands back seems to work. Pass interference calls.
Did last night at dinner, and the check came with you. Thanks for the offer to buy, by the way.
Yeah, anytime. Tony's is not a cheap one.
They're going to pick on Hefner right now with Toppin.
Oster gave it up.
Good ball movement, huh?
Another three. Now 28 of their 57 of attempts today have come from deep. Dennis squares up. Shibway the rebound. Jimmy, a lot of people are going to look at Shibway's numbers against Georgia and Shibway's numbers today. And there's Reeves for three.
And say what changed.
Yep.
Well, the defensive scheme for Texas A&M is to take Oscar Shibway out of the game and make others make shots. Reeves just knocked down another three from the side corner. And Shibway with a really good pass that they had trapped the life out of 34 and White in front of the rim. And where do you go with the ball when you're trapped? You find the backside, not the same side. Watch Shibway. There he is. Dribbles to find the backside. Reeves is set. Rise, release, rotation, and Rupp erupts.
I want to show you what happened under the basket with Oscar Shibway and Henry Coleman when that three was going in a moment ago.
Well, and Buzz Williams got right in the ear of the officials at the beginning of the timeout because of that play right there. He felt like Shibway, again, gets his elbow into Coleman and throws him down. Maybe Coleman also had a hook and hold. Regardless, those two big dudes are going at it, body on body. And Shibway has to understand how important he is, and Coleman has to understand how important he is. Neither one of them can cross the line right now and get a retaliation foul.
And the importance of this game will be felt on Selection Sunday if both teams stay on their same trajectory. As of today, Joe Lunardi has both Kentucky and A&M outside of the field, both among the first four out. A&M has not lost in a conference game yet.
A&M started last year 4-0 in SEC play, lost to Kentucky, and went on to lose seven straight after that, a turning point in their season. This A&M team is better, deeper, and more talented than last year.
Meanwhile, on the Kentucky side, they've attempted 29 threes in this game. It's the most for the Cats since a game against Chattanooga in 2011. Shibway out of the double, gets rid of it. Frederick for three. And it's rebounded and kept alive. They'll launch another three. And Shibway somehow tips it in.
How about the heart? But the soft set of paws by Shibway. On the backside, he is phenomenal at reading the ball and understanding where misses come from.
7-0 Kentucky run. Shebe the rebound. Wallace walked with it and they almost missed it.
That's on Toppin though, Tom. He's running up the floor without his eyes on the ball. I mean, Wallace is thinking, I'm throwing this thing ahead just like we work every day. Toppin running blindly forces Wallace into a travel call. Watch Shebe get on the backside of where the ball comes from. It's a math equation for Shebe with the shots in the air. Every once in a while, when you're National Player of the Year, things just go your way. Traffic, soft pause.
The Wildcats, they got a little energy in that ball right now. That thing is hopping.
Well, here's the story right now, Seth. In this heavyweight fight, Julius Marble just returned to the game, and Boots Radford goes again. He's got 18 this half.
He goes left and lefter.
Yeah.
Has not beaten Kentucky one time today, Tom Hart to his right.
He should be in politics.
Yeah, Kentucky just cannot keep this kid from getting to his strong side. Yeah, to Seth's point, the juice is back in the building in Rupp. They believe, Kentucky does, that they got things figured out. Toppin now trying to isolate at the nail. We'll look to go high-low. There it is.
And that double team came from the bottom, and from Wade Taylor commits his second foul.
Calipari has gone a two-man game with Toppin at the nail feeding Oscar Shebe down low. That double team continues to come from the low side, but Shebe is not hesitating. He's beating the double team, getting the ball up on the glass before the double team can interfere.
Toppin with some words for Shebe, who's missed his only free throw attempt of the game. Oscar has held scoreless in a half for just the third time this season, once against Alabama, once against South Carolina State. Makes his first big Monday doubleheader coming your way. Duke, after the home win today, 500th consecutive sellout of Cameron, will travel Castle Coliseum to take on Virginia Tech. And then number two, Kansas, coming off of back-to-back Big 12 losses, will be on the road in Waco to take on Baylor.
Man, TCU thumped Kansas today. That's the second largest home loss for Bill Self at Kansas. TCU's first win in Allen Fieldhouse. Something is not right in Jayhawk Nation.
Good feed from Taylor to Marble.
What a play. To screen that top and just simply roll Marble in the middle third of the floor. No defensive rotation by Kentucky.
Double came to Shebe. Wallace goes the other way with it. Toppin.
Oh,
foul hard by Marble.
And Tom, the body blows in this game are continuing to escalate on every drive and every rebound. And Toppin took a hard hit and a hard fall, comes up a little gimpy.
It's a fourth personal on Marble.
If A&M's going to continue to double Oscar Shebe before he ever catches the ball, that ball's got to find the backside and attack A&M's rotation defensively like Kentucky just did.
Here's another look at the foul.
And they're looking at Marble. Was that more than just a common foul? Because he comes hard with a purpose. Hard body on body contact. Now he doesn't swing down and come down hard with his arms.
I think the biggest issue for Toppin is that left foot's swung through and couldn't get him any grip right there.
And also, Tom, is the offensive player in a vulnerable position once he leaves the ground? Is another thing you could look at to make it an F1.
Cal's coaching up Frederick and Shebe, taking advantage of this opportunity. You mentioned when the double comes, one of the points of emphasis John Calipari made with his team was to get a ball fake in there so the double would come early and then go elsewhere with it.
Just a common foul. It's a hard common foul, but just a common foul. Talked about the belief that Texas A&M plays with, man. They are tight. They protect what they believe. They embrace the game when it gets hard. Kentucky's had to embrace the hard parts of the game as well today. Kentucky, Tom, they're not getting to the free throw line. Only This is only their 10th free throw attempt in the ball game. And coming in, they had made 45 out of their last 55 over the last two games. So their inability to get to the stripe right now, a little bit of concern with under six to go.
It's Toppin's first attempt of the afternoon. That rims a second, but Wallace is there.
Kentucky runs a good free throw miss play.
Bam. Reeves for three.
Yeah, you don't box off. You don't take away Kentucky's free throw miss play. The ball somehow always finds a way to go in when defense mistake is made.
Reeves now 5 for 11 from three. They're going to stop with an injury timeout for Toppin, who couldn't continue and is having a hard time putting weight on that left ankle.
Tom Tshiebwe gets so much attention in the box off area of the game that someone else has a free rim, whether it's in a half court miss or a free throw miss. The attention to Tshiebwe gives a free rim to others. This time it was Cason Wallace. Look at Tshiebwe. He's got two bodies on him, and Cason Wallace just wins the foot race to the opposite side. Man, the value of Oscar Tshiebwe is hard to overstate.
16 second chance points for Kentucky to just two for A&M. Tshiebwe, good hands. Marble got it back, and then a foul on the floor. That'll be Oscar Shibway's fourth personal. And now Lance Ware will enter for Kentucky, and we'll try to protect Tshiebwe for the next few minutes.
And Lance Ware produced when Cal put him in earlier. He really fought, he ran, protected the rim for Kentucky. Not on the floor to score, on the floor to make winning plays that don't show up on the box score.
And four rebounds in 12 minutes. Radford went down. Taylor, wow, over Ware.
What a shot. Just enough separation on that 5-on-1 mismatch for Wade Taylor to step back. Nothing but the bottom. That's a tempo press to shorten the clock that Kentucky has to work with. 1-2-2 zone alignment, but you got to cut and start moving. They're just switching everything out and passing them off. Now it's straight man, late clock.
Wallace lobbed to Ware, wasn't there, and it's a Kentucky turnover.
It wasn't there, and Ware wasn't ready to go attack the ball. And coming out of that backside dunker spot, look at this shot here by, that's a 5-on-1 mismatch, and Wade Taylor stops, leans back just enough, not to throw his shot off, but to get it off. A 4-point game now with under five to go.
See who Buzz wants to go to here. Looking for Marble on Ware. Dennis forgot the basketball for a moment. Regathers and ends up drawing the foul, and they're going to get Lance Ware for his first.
You do not want to reach when that shot clock gets under 10. That foul has occurred at 7, and Sheboy's going to come back in. And you got A&M in a world of hurt right here. The reach in by Lance Ware with 7 on the shot clock bails out a bad offensive possession by Texas A&M.
What about the decision to get Oscar back in?
Well, he probably only has one or two trips up and down the floor before we get to the under four media timeout. Cal now, this thing going to be what? A 2-3 point game after the free throws.
And ostensibly an offense for defense sub with Tshiebwe coming in after one free throw.
He comes for Livingston, so now that combo of Tshiebwe and Ware on the floor. Haven't seen a lot of this lately. They've been going with one or the other.
And Coleman and Marble are on the floor for A&M, so big time bigs. Dennis knocks them both down. 2-point game.
Tempo press again. It's been a tempo press to a 1-2-2 look, and then matching up man late clock for Texas A&M. Has Kentucky standing a little bit on the offensive end.
Tshiebwe guarded by Marble. Dennis was sinking in on him. Shot clock at 10. Here's Reeves.
Walked.
Skipped his feet.
Tom, Texas A&M, they make you make quick decisions. Not only in basketball, but in life. When you make quick decisions, they don't always turn out like they should. And that confusing defense by Texas A&M has Kentucky right now a little bit stagnant.
It'll stay with A&M, 18 seconds on the shot clock. Radford has been the go-to guy this second half for Texas A&M. 18 of his 20 have come after the intermission.
Amazing. Texas A&M has taken 20 fewer shots than Kentucky in this game.
Three off the mark. Chiboy's got the rebound. Kentucky shooting just 37% from the floor, and A&M is over 50.
Man-to-man straight defense. Texas A&M just switches that initial floppy action on Reeves and Frederick.
Wallace drives and gets all the way to the rim.
That's hard to do against Texas A&M because they pursue the ball when you try to punch the paint.
Loose ball off of A&M.
Mason Wallace, not easy to get the ball cleanly against Texas A&M when you're running offense. But Wallace on the single side, there's no one in the corner. It's a naked, empty corner drive attempt by 22 in white. Well done.
Tom.
All right, KC, thanks. We got a four-point game with 3:24 to play here at Rupp as A&M still undefeated in conference play at 5-0. Kentucky's put up more threes than any other game since 2011 when they launched 33 against Chattanooga.
Well, A&M has made it very difficult for Kentucky to get that ball inside, and when they have, every time Chiboy's touched it, it's been two defenders and a third one coming quickly, forcing Kentucky to beat you from the perimeter today. So far, the Aggies.
Toppin hopping around. He's back after returning from the ankle injury. I think he changed shoes, oddly enough. There's that three-quarter court look. And a near turnover.
That was ugly.
Frederick looking for Chiboy. Now Toppin doing the same. Shot clock at 7. Frederick, quick pass inside, and Chiboy can't finish.
Well, good job to hold your ground defensively against Chiboy and not let him release the ball going towards the rim. I am so impressed with A&M's ability to fly around and X out action, attack the ball, and still recover with terrific closeouts.
A&M's going to take a timeout. 2:35 to play in regulation. Kentucky up 65-61, and the Aggies will have 10 seconds left on the shot clock coming out of this 30-second timeout.
You want me to tell you what option one and two is?
Yeah.
Boots Radford getting the ball going to his left. And Buzz Williams took the timeout on that side of the floor, which makes you think that not only could Boots Radford take it out and he'd get it right back, and now he's naturally coming right down with his left paw from that right side. If you want your right-handed driver to get it going downhill, Tom, you bring the ball over here in front of us.
Yeah.
And let him get the ball on this side of the floor going to his right. Buzz Williams took the ball over there to call timeout. I think this is Radford now getting to that left paw trying to make the play.
Radford's made a couple of threes in this game, which is a bit of a rarity. Yeah. What kind of impact does that have on what they draw up and how it's defended?
Well, if you're Kentucky, you can't back off the kid because he's got the good eyes right now in this gym. Radford's going to start away from the ball on the far side. I just anticipate him coming to the ball, getting the ball on the right side, and attacking that paint with his left. And Wallace is the primary defender on him right now. They don't do it. Radford sticks his head under the rim and lets Wade Taylor make the drive.
Taylor misses. Chiboy rips the rebound away.
Surprised. Really surprised that was not for Radford, as good as he's been in the second half.
16th rebound for Oscar Chiboy, 3 points away from what would be his 12th double-double of the season.
They're just passing people off. You can call it a matchup zone or a man-to-man that's passing everything off, switching every position.
Reeves off the glass and in.
That's a hard drive. The rim is freed up because A&M is not coming off of Chiboy. They're not rotating over to drivers. Kentucky now making him pay because of it.
Reeves having a monster game. He's got 21. And another timeout taken by Texas A&M. This will be the Aggies' final timeout.
I talked about the value, Tom, of Oscar Tshiebwe. His defender is not coming off as that ball gets driven. So therefore, the left side of the rim on this last possession is open and free. Watch the attraction of Tshiebwe on the bottom side of your screen right there. Marble is not rotating over to the ball. They're forcing Wallace to make a tough shot. Excuse me, Reeves. But man, the value of Tshiebwe shows up in so many ways that don't show up on that stat sheet. Coming out of this timeout, I'll be shocked if this is not for Radford getting to his left side.
Well, Reeves has now hit 9 of his last 17 threes. He's hit 5 in this one. He's one off of his season high as a Kentucky Wildcat. He's got 21.
And coaches told us today that defensively, Kentucky has gone to another level, primarily because of Reeves and Livingston, how they've grown defensively. They've gone back to the basics of what they do and how they guard multiple actions. But Reeves and Frederick on the floor completely changes how you have to defend Kentucky.
Radford 20 points on 7 of 8. Reeves 21. And for Reeves, 5 of his 7 makes have come from 3. Remember, Radford only had 2 at the half. A&M basketball, they put more time on the shot clock. There's 19 seconds on the shot clock.
And Hooch Radford is underneath the rim right now. See where he goes, where he wants the ball, where they get it to him.
He gives it up. Does he get it back? On the handoff, Wallace tried to blow it up. And they'll get Wallace for his third personal. And Cason Wallace is the rarity. He is a freshman in his first year college basketball that is an elite defender.
And he adds size to that Kentucky defensive team as opposed to when Wheeler's on the floor. When Kentucky has their big lineup, now offensively, you're seeing 5-on-5. When there's a small guard on the floor, not just Sevier Wheeler, but any team that plays a 5'8", 5'9 guard, offensively, Tom, you're playing 5-on-4 defenders because that small guy really doesn't impact your vision at all. Important free throws by Radford. Tough guy on the stripe and late clock. Probably automatic.
A&M is perfect from the free throw line. 15 for 15.
They came in today making 16 per game in conference play. And they're about to hit their average here with another make. There it is.
22-point effort for Radford. That's 10 more than his season average. They've extended the press now to go full court. Reeves takes it all the way, and he floats it in.
And the gumption of Reeves to attack the press and make a hard floater. Really well done. Got the ball at the sidelines, got it to the middle third of the floor quickly.
Wallace overplaying the left. Radford takes advantage and slips it to Coleman.
They go empty side ball screen. They force Toppin to be the ball screen defender. Steps out up on the ball. Easy pocket pass for 2.
Cats have made 5 of their last 6 from the floor.
Al has 2 timeouts if he doesn't like what he sees.
Under a minute to play. Shot clock now at 10. They'll spread the floor. Wallace behind Oscar's screen. Here's Frederick now. Pull up. Got
and
it.
Money. What a vicious cut by Frederick to run to get the ball to start with and to stay under control and not shoot an off-balance jumper.
Radford had it partially blocked by Wallace. Missed opportunity. Kentucky leads by 6, a half minute to play. And Buzz is trying to get his guys to foul. Coleman hasn't done it yet.
Man, Tom, I'm telling you, the cut more important than the release sometimes. Watch Frederick knowing late clock, I've got to win the foot race to the ball. And then to get himself gathered under control, really well done, forcing Andre Gordon to fly by. Such a smart, high IQ, tough kid. Always in the right position defensively. As that finger gets better, those three-point shots are going to start to drop. A slugfest right now that Kentucky's trying to get out of Rupp Arena with another conference win.
C.J. Frederick has not missed a free throw in conference play, and he's given the Cats now their largest lead of the game. Good shooter remains perfect from the stripe in the league. Kentucky 26 seconds away from handing A&M its first conference loss of the season. And that would put Alabama all alone in first place in the SEC.
And again, heavy minutes today by Calipari with these five guys that are on the floor right now.
Step back, Wade Taylor. Got it!
That's a two. His foot was on the line. An absolute must. Still gain pressure on Kentucky to inbounds it and make free throws.
A&M going for the steal, and on the reach, Dennis stops the clock and puts Cason Wallace at the free throw line.
The balance on Dennis, that's his second and the team's second.
Amazing coming in today. Cason Wallace, only two free throw attempts in conference play. Clearly the right foot on the line on the last basket by Texas A&M.
Wallace has another one coming.
Will be the third win in a row for Kentucky. They go to Vanderbilt, I believe, the middle of the week.
Yeah, it's Tuesday night on the SEC Network.
A monster, monster opportunity for Kentucky in this building next Saturday against Kansas.
Shibwe had the rebound. It ends up with Toppin. And he'll get fouled with 11 ticks left on the clock. I was talking to C.J. Frederick before the game today about his reaction to John Calipari in the Tennessee win. There was a big hug. There was a smile from John Calipari. And he said, we knew what our coach was going through. We knew the arrows that he was taking from the fans, from the media, from everybody being critical of him. We wanted to win that game for our coach, and we were able to do it. We weren't happy necessarily for ourselves as much as we were happy for John Calipari.
Yeah, they believe in their coach 1,000%. Both these teams do. You can't have more belief in how you're supposed to play the game than Texas A&M does. I talked to Cal that night after the Tennessee win by Kentucky. And his response to what you just said was the first thing out of his mouth, I'm so happy for my guys because it's hard to play at Kentucky. And when things aren't going well, you want to see things finally turn the corner. Kentucky has turned the corner. They have figured out what works for them.
Radford for three. Would be fitting for his afternoon for that one to have gone down. Kentucky's going to hold on. It'll be the third straight win for the Cats, and it's the first SEC loss of the season for Buzz Williams and Texas A&M. For Jimmy Dykes, our fantastic crew, our final. Cats 76, Aggies 67. Time to get you to Baton Rouge. Here's Courtney Lyle and Dave Bradshaw.